Thank you so much, Brother Sal, for that message this evening. That really helped me and gave me a lot of encouragement for our country, pointing fingers at politicians and school system and so many other things. Maybe if we just do our job, God can continue to extend his mercy to America. And I certainly do appreciate that. Good to see you. I don't believe Brother Sal is an old man or an older man. But he's been in the ministry a long time, and he doesn't seem to be a sour, bitter preacher, does he? Isn't that a blessing? That's a blessing. Some guys, they're in the ministry for a while, and you know, it seems that it rubs on them, and they just kind of have to bear that burden and yoke. I'm glad it's just good to be saved and be in God's ministry. And I don't know about anybody else tonight, but there's just something been inside my heart and soul just standing up and saying yes to everything that's been sung. I mean, those girls singing about Jesus Christ and somebody singing about his name and all that, man, something inside just keeps wanting to say, yeah, that I'm in, I'm saved, that's me, it's good. And just wants to say, yeah, and he's worthy of praise, and he's worthy of our worship, and my hand just keeps wanting to go up, and something wants to come out of my heart, and I'm just telling you, I'm glad I'm born again. I know it's Friday night, hey, but I'm in church on a Friday night. I'm not in some house of ill repute, man. I'm with God's people. I got a Bible in front of me. I got heaven in front of me. Hey, man, it's good to be saved. What a Savior. What a blessing to be born again. And I just rejoice over that. Take your Bible tonight and look, if you would, Luke 22 tonight. Luke 22, we're approaching Calvary, and if there's ever been a battle and a victory won, it was won at Calvary. And Jesus Christ, our great captain of salvation, our victor. But there was a real battle that took place there. And tonight, I really don't tend to be long. I think we've already heard what we need to hear. I really just kind of want to call your attention to that direction about your spiritual battle, the battle that takes place. And I don't know how many committed just a moment ago to win 10 or to win 1 or to do your best to do that. But I promise you this, if you committed in your heart to do that and you get involved in doing that, as good as this singing has been, you're going to face a foe out there that's not going to want you to accomplish what you've purposed in your heart. It's easy to go to an altar many times, and some churches don't go at all. It sure has been a blessing to see so many people here at this altar, but going to an altar is not the same thing as making a choice to live what you committed to do. And when you do that, it many times there's a battle, and there's a battle outside these doors. And I think that Old Paths Baptist Church is not a church that's unfamiliar with that fight. I believe that this church is in the good fight of faith. I believe this church right here, I looked out there in the auditorium, the old auditorium, and the number of missionaries you sent out. This church is sending missionaries, not just supporting. How many missionaries do you support, Brother Folk? Do you know? How many do you support, Brother Barkowski? 101. Do you know how many countries? 101 countries in 50 countries? I'd say that's a church that's doing something for the Lord Jesus. Amen? That's something to get excited about. And then how many out of this church? How many missionaries out of the church? 18? 19? 15 missionaries out of this church. Not only does this church support missionaries, but it's sending missionaries. That's kind of like Fort Benning, Georgia. Fort Benning, Georgia is training Rangers to send out to get the job done. And it's not just that they support what's going on in the military. They're sending out those soldiers to get the job done. And I believe this church is involved in that. You go out on the streets. I know you're involved in the schools. Let me tell you right now, the devil does not want the Bible in the school. The Bible doesn't want the Lord Jesus Christ in front of children. I mean, this country's children, there are so many things today that I believed when I was a young child that are not believed today. There are so many things today that I'm only 50, but I am so far removed from the trends of the culture of this society. But you know what? Jesus Christ can set those things right. And when you take the Bible into a school and you take the Word of God into a school, you know what you're doing? You're going on the enemy's territory, and I praise the Lord for it. That's a blessing. Amen. Going out there at the parade, passing out tracts. I mean, it's a blessing. All those bands coming down through there, and they're playing their drums and all that good stuff. But there's another band of people out there. They got all these gospel tracts, and they're going through there, and they're giving out the gospel of Jesus Christ and talking about, you know, I say this is a church that's involved in the good fight of faith. Amen. And it's a good thing to be part of a church like that. But that battle is not going to miss you as a believer. The reason I say that is, if you'll look down at verse number 53, just read one verse, and then we'll look at many things in chapter 22 and 23. Jesus is looking at Judas and this band of religious people that have come to take him captive, and he says this, "When I was daily with you in the temple, ye stretched forth no hands against me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness." Everything that we read in Luke 22 and 23, there is a power of darkness that is working behind that scene. There is a spiritual battle that's taking place, not just a physical battle that's taking place. And you and I, we're told in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12 that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. In other words, our battle is very real. We are in a battle. We may not always see it that way, but we are in a battle. One of my favorite passages of Scripture in the Bible is 2 Timothy 2, about being a good soldier. And the Bible says that no man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that we are in a real battle. It's a real fight. It's something that is not imaginary. It's not something that we've made up in our mind. Now, I am not of the persuasion, neither do I believe, that I have apostolic gifts, that I can go out and cast out devils, or that I'm to go into some area and somehow cast out the devil that's over top of the community of Rochester or anything like that. But I do believe this. I believe I'm in a real spiritual battle, and it shows its face sometimes on the way to church. Sometimes it shows its face during a church service. Sometimes it shows its face in moments that I wouldn't expect it to be there, but that battle all of a sudden gets very real, and it's not something that I can just dismiss as coincidence. It's not just something that just happened. There's a force that's at work. Would you look, Luke 22, speaking about this battle, look how real this battle is. Luke 22 and verse 3, the Bible says, "Then entered Satan into Judas, surnamed Iscariot, being of the number of the 12, one of the 12 disciples, and Satan entered into him." He entered into one of the choice men in that entire group of people. Satan stepped across a line, and he entered into a man that the Lord had trained, that kept the bag, that saw the miracles, that heard the words that Jesus spoke, that watched him pray. Satan stepped across and grabbed one of his best men and entered into him. Now, whether you believe all that's foreordained, and boy, I appreciate what was said about Calvinism, I believe the Bible says that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Amen. I believe Judas had a choice. But Satan stepped into his life. It goes on further, chapter 22, look at verse number 31. He's not satisfied there. Satan is at work behind the scenes. Nobody really right now at this point recognizes it, but he's at work, verse 31. "And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. Not only does he have Judas, but now he is after Simon Peter." He wants Simon Peter, and I've preached that here before, being sifted in Satan's sifter. He wants to get all the good out of Peter's life and hold up all the wickedness there. There's a spiritual battle taking place. Here is Peter, this man that Jesus Christ has touched his life, and he's forsaken his job and forsaken his family business, and he's followed the Lord Jesus Christ, and now Satan says, "I've got this one, and I'm working on this one," and it's a real battle. It's real. It's not something being imagined. It's not just something, well, that's just Adamic nature. No, it's a real battle, a real struggle that's taking place. Look at it even further. Verse number 21, the Bible says, "But behold, the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table." What a terrible place for the devil to show up and do battle at a table. Hey, listen, how many of you, listen, this is ridiculous to ask this question. How many of you enjoy eating? Eating's not the time to fight, is it? I mean, if you're going to fight, fight after the meal. You don't fight before the meal, but during the meal, let's enjoy the meal. All right, let's get to the dessert. When the dessert's over with, take it outside, do what you got to do. But right now, let's just, and especially if you go to a nice restaurant, if somebody's going to spend $50, $100, $200, let's not have any bitterness at the table. I tell you something else, let's not have the table. It has nothing to do with the message. Let's not have any earbuds in our ear while we're eating. Amen. I almost, in my heart, I feel like somebody that just, you know, if all they can do is just listen while everybody else eats, maybe they need to go ahead and be left with the bill. Amen. No, let's have fellowship. That's what the table is about. That table is about fellowship. That table is about having communion. That's exactly what happens at that Last Supper. There is communion going on with the Lord and with his apostles. He's desired to sit and be with them. And Satan has come in and put his hand at the table. That battle has reached to a place that it should never reach. I wish the only place the devil fought the cause of Christ was in the world and in the church, but he fights that in the home as well. He fights it sometimes between husband and wife. Sometimes the battle is between children and their parents. That battle gets so real. And what I'm saying is that this battle that's taking place in Luke 22 and 23 is a real battle. It is a real fight. And something I would like you to consider tonight when you walk out these doors is that you may leave this place, but you have a real enemy and a real foe, and there is a real battle that is raging and takes place. And that word battle I chose for a particular reason. A war is a long campaign. A war is something that takes place sometimes maybe over many, many years. But a battle is something that takes place in a moment of time. When I was a younger pastor, I believed this. I taught that Satan has a long-term plan to destroy every church, every Christian, every marriage. I believed that he had a long-term plan. But, you know, I've come to the realization, I'm glad that Satan is not omniscient. He doesn't know everything. Amen. Now, my God knows everything, but Satan does not know everything. But I tell you what I think he does. I think he works very hard on the moment. The moment in front of you is a very prime time for him. He gets Eve at that tree. That is a prime moment right there. That's a moment. When he gets David up on top of the rooftop and there's Bathsheba, that is a moment. And he's focusing his efforts on that moment because he knows this. If you do something that is wrong in that moment, then it does affect your future down the road. But it's a real battle. It's a real battle. It's not something imaginary. It's something that's real. I remember the first time that I ever had another human being strike me in the face, apart from my brother when we were fighting. You know, we never hit each other. We'd play around, but I was riding my bicycle in my neighborhood on a gravel road behind my house, and I'd ridden on it before, and as I was riding this bicycle, this dog in a fence began barking at me, and I said, "Shut up!" And I kept riding. I heard somebody say, "Hey!" And so I stopped my bicycle, and I turned around. The guy, he's just walking this way in his yard, and he comes to me. He said, "Hey, man." And I said, "Hey, how you doing?" I'm sitting on my bicycle, and as he gets a little bit closer, he said, "Did you tell my dog to shut up?" And I said, "I did." And he hit me right in the face. Look at these guys laughing. That's great. I'd never been hit before. I didn't know what to do next. He hit me in the face. You know what I did? I went over sideways. And then when I went over sideways, the next thing, the fear flight thing came up. Run, pedal, get away. No discussion. And I did. I got on that bike, and I don't know if I ever went back down that gravel road again. I definitely never went by and told his dog to shut up again. That's for sure. Bark all you want to. I'd never been hit. You know, sometimes I fear that what we as Christians, you know, we sing the song, "The Fight Is On," you know, and "Onward Christian Soldiers." And what we don't understand is that there is a real, real fight. And that battle is real, and there are casualties. You know, sometimes we hear about men, or we hear about people in churches that have gone, and they've gone the way of the world, or they've left the Lord Jesus Christ or the principles of the Bible, and we wonder how could that happen. You know what many times happens? Somebody that was in the fight, somebody that was doing something for the Lord, somebody that was saved and was genuine, you know what happened to them? They got in a battle, and they lost the battle, and they became a casualty in the war. There are young people that used to sit in this building, casualties. There are preachers that you know that are no longer in the ministry, casualties. There are mothers that used to be godly women at their home that one day left a note for their husband, "I no longer want anything to do with this," and they changed their whole lifestyle. You know what that is? That's a casualty. That's a real battle. And the battle is real. It's real. But many times that battle is something you can't really see. It's not something visible to you. If you look with me down, look what the Bible says here down in verse number 47. I think it was hidden from view. It wasn't something everyone recognized what was going on. They didn't understand the battle that was taking place. In verse number 47, the Bible says, "And while he yet spake, behold, a multitude. And he that was called Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near unto Jesus to kiss him." Here Jesus is being kissed. Really, if Satan has entered into Judas, he's almost being kissed by Satan. I mean, all around, I don't know that anybody is recognizing what is going on, but Satan has entered Judas, and Judas is placing his lips on the Lord Jesus Christ's cheek. There's a battle that's going on right there, but nobody is sensing that. They don't see that. All they see is Judas walking up to kiss Jesus. They don't see Satan in him. They don't see what's going on around in that hour and power of darkness. All they see is a man that they knew walking up to kiss their Savior. The battle sometimes is veiled from us. We can't see it. Look at it again. In chapter 23, look at verse number 10. They question Jesus, and the Bible says, "Then he questioned with him in many words," verse 9, "but he answered him nothing. And the chief priest and scribes stood and vehemently accused him." Now I want you to think about the wording there for just a minute. It's the power of darkness. Satan is motivating Judas in his actions. And here the chief priest and scribes are not just accusing him. They're not just saying, "Art thou the Christ? Tell us. They are vehement in what they're doing. They're angry. The blood is up. It's boiling. They are vehement in what they're doing. "Yeah, tell us if thou be the Christ." And they're engaged. And if you looked at that scene, what you would say is, that's a bunch of religious men that are angry at that man right there that's done nothing wrong, that's saying nothing. But there's a whole lot more going on behind the scenes that you don't see. I believe all my heart that Satan is prodding them to say those things and priming them to say those things. He's whispering in their ear and he's stirring up that dead religion in their heart. And while everybody else just sees maybe a kangaroo court trial, really what's going on is a spiritual battle is taking place. But they can't see it. They can't see it because it's a spiritual battle. It's a battle that's taking place in another realm that they don't see visibly with their eyes. Chapter 23, look at verse number 3. "And Pilate asked him, saying, Art thou the King of the Jews? He answered him and said, Thou sayest it." You know, if we went to John, as I watch Pilate ask Jesus questions, he's asking him questions, and all the while asking him those questions, he is so in the dark about what's going on. I mean, he even gets to the place and says, "Knowest thou not that I have power to deliver thee?" And Jesus looks at him and says, "Thou hast no power at all." He doesn't know. Listen, he's tried him and he's not found him guilty in anything. He sent him to Herod, not found guilty in anything. And I've got this murderer. I've got Barabbas here, and you want me to release Barabbas to you guys? And you guys want me to crucify Jesus, and he's wanting to wash his hands? He's in the middle of all this, but I don't think he understands the battle going on around him. But I'm going to tell you what we heard just a minute ago about those lost people out there, they don't understand the judgment that faces them. They don't understand the hell that awaits them. They don't understand the penalty of that sin. They don't understand lost people drink and they waste their lives because they don't understand what they could be free from. They're in the dark. And Pilate's in the middle of this fight, and it is a real battle. It's a battle that's real, but it's hidden from view. And that's true, I believe, in our lives. I'm going to say a few things here for just a few minutes. I think that we have battles that take place that we sometimes don't recognize are spiritual battles, and they affect us in the bigger scheme of things. There's a bigger, more important issue out there at stake, but the devil is trying to deal with us in this moment of time. If he can get us bent out of shape, if he can get us somehow bent the wrong direction, then he knows it's going to affect the outcome, just like we heard preached a minute ago. Lot's sitting in the gate. His daughters are in the wrong place, the wrong lifestyle. And because of that, nobody leads anybody to Christ. When he goes to his sons-in-law, they laugh at him and they mock him. Because look, Lot, what you're saying can't be true. Man, what is wrong with you? They won't have anything to do with what he says because of the lifestyle they've lived. It's affected a greater, more important opportunity. And here Jesus is going to the cross. And this battle, it's very real. It's very, very often, it's not something you can see. And now I want you to step with me a few verses and look at Jesus. Look at 22:48. I want to say something to you about a spiritual battle that comes up in your life. All right? If God will help me. The spiritual battles that take place in your life, when you come to a battle in your life and things aren't right and things are not in where they ought to be, instead of just thinking it's somebody else's problem, maybe somebody else is at fault, maybe sometimes it would be best to step back and wonder, is there a battle taking place that I don't understand here? The spiritual battles in our lives cannot be made to be personal. They cannot be allowed to become personal. Preach to young people this morning. I'm preaching to adults right now. Jesus Christ, verse 48 of chapter 22, the Bible says that Judas betrays him with a kiss. Jesus said unto him, Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss? The Bible goes on to say, in another gospel, that he calls him friend. Jesus is in the middle of this battle for the souls of men. He's going to the cross of Calvary to win that victory that we've heard sung about tonight and heard preached about how that we could carry that to a lost world. He's going there to win the battle with sin and with hell and with death. But on the way in that battle, he has many things that happen to him personally. Judas comes up and kisses him. His friend comes up and kisses him. And he doesn't take it personally. Now listen, may get a little personal tonight. Sometimes there are things that happen in your life that are not just by accident and not just because, hey, it's just a bad day. Satan is pulling strings behind the scenes, and two people that used to walk together that were friends and that had good fellowship, one of them will wound one of the other ones. And it happens at church. Listen, you can't be together like this crowd. Listen, you can't be together like this crowd at last year's picnic. How many had a good time last year's picnic? Was last year a good picnic? Wasn't that a good picnic? But we had a little contention at the picnic, didn't we? Yeah. We even saw two brothers, I can still see them in my mind, going for a football. Right there on the field, and the next thing I hear is crack. And I hear, see, two brothers laying on the ground. Nigh death. And if you're not careful, what will happen is, it's not by accident. Somebody will say something to you wrong. Somebody will do something that you don't appreciate. That's your friend or that's your brother in this church. Maybe they didn't respond the way you wanted them to respond. Or maybe they said, "Listen, sometimes the older I get, the more I understand. I understand you cannot always hear what people have to say." My grandfather, you talk to him, and so many times he'd say this. He'd just say, "Huh." He'd say, "Huh," whether he heard you or not. "Hey, Granddad, you ready to go? Huh?" And if you didn't say anything, he'd say, "Sure, what time?" Huh? And sometimes you and I, we hear things. We hear something that we think somebody said that maybe they didn't say, or maybe they didn't say it in the context in which you were told they said it. Somebody brought you the news of something that they heard someone else say about you. And the next thing you know, you're getting offended and you're taking something personal. And that is not by accident. I cannot believe they let their son sit with their daughter. I cannot believe that I heard that they did this at their house last weekend and excluded us. And we've been there for the last 10 years. And it's because he was sitting next to her. Hey, newsflash. The devil might be behind some little battle you can't see, trying to destroy you and your relationship with somebody else and your relationship with a church and your relationship with the Lord so you don't get to lead those 10 people to Jesus Christ. The wound of a friend. Listen, it hurts when somebody hurts you that's close to you. When somebody that's close to you does something that hurts your heart and you sit back and say, I can't believe they did that. I can't believe they said that. I don't understand why that took place. That is a wound, but I'm telling you, Jesus, when Judas came up, he did not do what we do. What would you have done if Judas walked up to you and you knew what was in his heart? What are you for here, you hypocrite? Why'd you come stepping up here? Don't call me friend. You know why you're here. He knew why Judas was there. He could have exposed him, but you know what he did? He gave an opportunity for Judas to turn around. And sometimes a friend wounds you, and they hurt you. That's why I don't like the best the BFF, the best friends for life. You need to have a lot of best friends. Well, that didn't go well. I'll say it again. You need to have a lot of best friends. Your best friend might fall out of fellowship with the Lord and leave you all alone, and then you're going to have problems because you're not anybody else's friend. You ought to make friends with all of God's people. You say, they're not like me. Hallelujah! Jesus had a friend. I'm talking about a friend. Hurt him. You know what's going on? Spiritual battle. But he didn't get bitter about it. Look at it again. Peter, look at Peter. Look at Peter, chapter 22. Look at verse 61. Verse 60. And Peter said, man, I know not what thou sayest. And immediately while he yet spake, the cock crew, and the Lord turned and looked upon Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said unto him, before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. Here you have a man that is a friend, but he's absent. He doesn't just betray the Lord. He's not betraying. He's just denying. He's absent. He's not there when he should be. Listen, aren't you glad the Bible says that there's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother? Aren't you glad the Lord Jesus Christ will be with you no matter what you're going through? The Bible speaks about how that it's better to have a neighbor that is near, because that neighbor can be a friend to you when nobody else is around. A brother that's far off, he can't do anything about it. I'm glad I got a friend that can stick closer than a brother. And hey, if you're part of Old Pass Baptist Church, you got a lot of good people here that are good neighbors and good friends that can help you when things don't go well and when the enemy tries to turn and hurt your family or somebody else. I praise the Lord for being part of a fellowship like this. You know, sometimes they just don't know. Why didn't they call me? I can't tell you as a pastor, sometimes the things that people get upset about really just, it amazes me. There's a lot of things that I do that I understand why people get upset about. I understand, I do, I get that. But you know, pastor, you didn't call me last week and I was sick. I didn't know you were sick. If I'd known you were sick, I would have called you. Well, it's okay. No, it's not okay. No, you've been upset for 4 days that I didn't call you because you were sick and I didn't know you were sick. And maybe what they're saying is you weren't there for me. And Jesus is going through he is in the hottest part of the battle of his life, and one of his best men has betrayed him with a kiss. He's wounded him, and another one is just denying him, standing afar off, and just letting him go through it alone. And I'm telling you, the devil is so good, he'll take and he'll manipulate families and he'll manipulate things and circumstances and sometimes think, listen, sometimes there is no malice in what happens sometimes. Sometimes people don't know. Sometimes people don't understand. How many of you admit this, that you have done things in ignorance that you never intended to do to anybody and didn't intend to hurt them, but you hurt them deeply? Would there be anybody like that here? I have a great song leader and his wife. They're such sweet people. And our Mother's Day, this has been many years ago, I walked in and I'm shaking hands and I'm saying, Happy Mother's Day, Happy Mother's Day, Happy Mother's Day. And they have not been able to have children, I guess now, 18 years. And they're there, very, very sweet couple. And I reached over to get his hand or her hand and I said, Happy Mother's Day. And as soon as I did, I realized what I'd said. And the countenance on her face, it told the story. That hurt. And I just said, I'm so sorry. Before service, I went over to her husband and I said, listen, I went up to your wife and I told her Happy Mother's Day and I'm so sorry. And you know what he said to me? He said, Preacher, that's all right. Don't worry about it. We love you. We know you weren't doing anything with intention. You know, sometimes we do things not intentionally. And it hurts somebody. Something you do by accident. Anybody here ever bumped into somebody else's car and didn't tell them about it? Boy, look at the righteous looks on the faces now. Not me. No, I didn't bump that door. I didn't bump that. Listen, we do things by accident. We don't do them on purpose. Peter did it on purpose, though. But you know what's going on? He's being sifted. There's a bigger picture going on here. There's something going on that is not just somebody not there when they should be. There's a bigger battle taking place, and that battle is Christ is going to the cross to win the victory. And instead of getting bitter and angry with Peter, the Bible says in verse 61 that he turned and he looked upon him. You know, he looked upon him. I believe their eyes met. I do not believe that he, and the people debate about, well, how could he see him being so far off? Met the Lord has no problem with distance or anything else. But I don't believe he looked at him with disdain. I don't believe he looked at him angry. I think he looked at him with disappointment, but with a face that said, Peter, I love you. There were times my mother, I wish my mother, has my mother ever been here, brother Folk? My mother's 5 feet tall. I can put my chin on her head. She is like sugar, man. She is a sweet lady. And she loves Jesus. But, you know, she'd play our organ, and our organ's about like that. It was over here, and my brother and I, we would sit about where the pinzones are, and my dad, he was always busy walking around, and she'd get to playing that organ. I'm telling you, my mother, I've never heard my mother raise her voice. I know you don't believe that. This is not evangelistically speaking. I've just never heard her raise her voice. And she's just sweet as, she's just sweet, just a sweet lady. But she'd play that organ, and my brother and I would, you know, Brent would be doing something he shouldn't do and talking to me and getting me in trouble and all that kind of stuff like that. And while she's playing that organ, I could feel my mother looking at me. Now, I know you don't believe that either, but I don't care if you believe it or not. I felt it. And I would look up there, and my mother would be, she would just, I would be getting a look like, when I get off this thing, I am going to deal with you. And then there would be times my mother would look at me, and I remember, it would be a look of love, but with a wounded heart. Joel, why? Why are you continuing to live like this? She didn't get embittered at me. She didn't get angry with me. And the Lord, in the middle of this battle, I believe he looks at Peter the same way. And we have this battle going on around us and things going on and things going wrong and weird things happening that we can't explain and some unusual circumstance that comes up, and because it's a friend or a brother or a husband or a wife, it all of a sudden becomes so personal to me. You're doing that to me. You're hurting me. You're abandoning me. You're wounding me. And if you're not careful, then what comes behind that is a root of bitterness that grows down into your soul. And it'll keep you from doing what the Lord wants you to do with your life. Lord didn't look at Peter and take it personal. That battle wasn't personal. Look at chapter 23 and verse number 11. Look at verse number 11, chapter 23. This battle is real. It's real in your life. You wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. This battle sometimes is hidden from view. You don't understand what's really going on behind the scenes, but you can't allow it to become personal or it will rob you of your purpose. Verse 11 or verse 10, and the chief priests and scribes stood and vehemently accused him, and Herod with his men of war set him at naught and mocked him and arrayed him in a gorgeous robe and sent him again to Pilate. They mocked him. They're mocking Jesus Christ. Now his enemies, the world, is getting involved in the fight. And they're mocking. They're making fun. They're saying things scornfully and hurtfully. It's not just a friend denying or a friend taking and not being there where they should be. But now it's somebody that's actually saying something hurtful. And that's the world. Listen, when you go knocking on a door, you guys knock on doors up here, Brother Folk? You guys go door to door? Do you still do that? Can you do that up here? When you go door to door, you know, sometimes people are so scared to go door to door because of what might happen. And sometimes things happen that are, you know, not pleasant. I remember knocking on a door in Greenville, South Carolina on Wednesday evening before service. And Noel Hawks and I, big redheaded fellow, we walk up to this door and we get to the door and knock on that door. And this older gentleman comes to the door and the screen is open and he's standing on the other side. And he said, "Yes, can I help you?" And we said, "Well, we're from Sweet Springs. We're from Tabernacle Baptist Church and we just wanted to come by and talk to you about the Lord." And when we said that, oh, this 80-year-old man, 80, he had to be 80. I mean, look, he almost needed help to come out the door. He kicked the door open and he said, "Yo, get up, rah, rah, rah." And I couldn't even understand what he was saying. "Rah, rah, 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 rah." And I'm like, "Good night, good grief. What's wrong with this man?" He didn't appreciate the church. Some people don't appreciate the Savior. You know, that same day we're walking down the road, same day, and we hear somebody singing a hymn, and man, that was just refreshment. Oh, joy. Man, I can hear somebody singing a hymn, and it was an older lady, and and as we get closer, we walk up there, and we're so excited to talk to her because we just got yelled at and cursed at by an 80-year-old man. And we walk over there, "Hey, how are you doing?" "We're doing so well." "Hey, we're from Tabernacle Baptist Church. Heard you singing such good hymns." And she said, "Well, that's good. I love the Lord." And she said something in an unintelligible language. And she said, "I just gave you a revelation." And I said, "No, ma'am, you didn't give me a revelation." And she said, "Yes, I did." She said, "I just spoke by the Holy Ghost." I said, "No, you spake," and now we're fighting with a little old lady that was singing hymns. She says, "You better stop what you're saying. You're about to blaspheme the Holy Ghost," and she's getting mad. And I think I'll go somewhere else. But look, the world doesn't love the Lord Jesus Christ. And when they say something to you, some of you young people, I know you've been on the streets, and sometimes people curse, and sometimes people say very vicious things. You guys that work with some of the guys, what a blessing. Brother Joe says, you fished. You have gone and tried to take that circle of influence you have and knocked and talked to all those people. Hey, if you don't win any of them to Christ, you know what they'll never be able to say? "Nobody ever told me about Jesus Christ. Nobody cared for my soul." But listen, they'll say things, and they'll do things. They'll take and maybe put some ugly picture or some nasty thing in your locker, or they'll do something just to try to be ugly to you. Hey, that's the world. But they're saying it directly to Jesus, and they're mocking him. And you know what he doesn't do? He doesn't get angry, and he doesn't get mad and say, "You can't say that to me." He just keeps his mouth closed, and they just mock on. It's a real battle. It's a real battle, and you can't take it personally. And he doesn't take it personally. Let's look at one other verse in chapter 23. Look at verse 34. Excuse me, verse 33. And the Bible says, "And when they were come to the place which is called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Verse 33, I want you to think about that for a minute. Verse 33, they crucified him. That means they took his hand. And when he laid his hand on that rugged cross, that man's close enough to look on the Son of God. When he finishes that hand, he goes to the other hand. He's doing that to a man, the Bible says, whose visage is marred more than any other man. They have watched him carry his cross up into Golgotha. They have watched him do something they know a man should not be able to do. Reaches over and grabs that spike, comes to his feet. Now, these just aren't words that wound. These are actual physical wounds. These are things that are going into the body. These are things that are touching his flesh. And you know what they hear him say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He didn't take it personal. He didn't look at that man and scowl at him. Listen, this church has sent out some missionaries. And you know, when you go to the mission field, there are things that happen. There is a warfare that takes place. There is a battle that takes place. And sometimes it gets physical. I know a missionary, listen, they took and they assaulted his family. They beat him and his children, and they raped his daughter. That'd be hard not to take personally. You know what they did? They stayed there on the field, and the last count that I had gotten from them when he was on the field, they had planted over 80 churches in the country that he was in, trying to stop the work. And what I'm trying to say tonight is this. If there's some kind of weird problem between you and your wife or your husband, if there's some weird problem between you and another brother in church, if there's something strange going on with one of the friends that you have, maybe it's not just personal. Maybe it's more than that. Maybe it's the devil trying to take and stick his filthy, dirty hands into your life and somehow stop you in a moment so you can't do what God put you on this planet to do, and that's to be able to let everybody know there's a precious Savior that died for the sins of men, and his life is better than any other life that you could live. You know, the Bible says of Esau, lest failing of the grace of God, that root of bitterness spring up in you. You know, I'm going to say something. You know, I believe every failure is a failure of the grace of God. I believe that Jesus Christ, the Bible says, nay, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Boy, don't you like that? I can still remember Brother Earl Hughes saying, that means that we have won the battle and there's ammunition left over. We're more than conquerors. But many times we don't live that way. We live stressed out and distressed and put out with other people. And we live not with joy in our heart. Maybe for a moment while the singing is uplifting. And maybe for a moment while the preaching is really good. But when we walk out of the door and we go home, there is defeat and there's despair because something's not right. Hey, you know what I say? I say that God's grace is sufficient to help you do whatever you need to do and meet whatever you have in your life. God's grace is sufficient. Amen. A pastor's counsel is not sufficient, and sometimes a brother's love is not sufficient, but I'm telling you all right now, listen, God's grace is sufficient, amen. We can come boldly to the throne of grace to find or to obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Oh, there's so many times I have stopped things going on in our church, things going on in my life, and I've had to take a step back and say, no, wait a minute. This is not a personal thing. This is a spiritual battle taking place. This is a conflict. And the only way I'm going to win this thing is not take it personal, let God's grace get poured into this thing. That battle is real. That battle's not always seen. But you can win that battle. You know what Jesus did? He won every one of those personal attacks, went all the way to the cross of Calvary. The Bible says that he said, "It is finished." Don't you like it the way it's worded? And he bowed his head. He didn't just droop over. Oh, no, he was the victor. He said, "It is finished." And then 3 days later, like we heard it sung, 3 days later, man, they had a watch around the tomb. They had it sealed. The devil and all of his minions are there probably saying, man, we're not going to, couldn't stop him. On the third day, he gets up out of the tomb and he brings victory for you and I over sin, death, hell, and the grave. And none of it stuck to him. I know sometimes that it is hurtful and it is hard, but you have to remember that it's a spiritual battle that sometimes Satan puts pressure on. And if you'll give God the opportunity and not take it personally and say, "God, you know what I need right now? Oh, we just need your grace. Our sufficiency is of God." Listen, it's not through the church or the hymn book. It's not through the choir and the folks that sing in the box. Our sufficiency comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. "God, I need your help." And you know what I believe he'll do? I believe he'll show up and he'll help you. And you know what you can do? You can win this thing, and you can be a victor through the Lord Jesus Christ. Some of the most dear people that I've ever met in my life are people that have been severely attacked and broken throughout their life, and they learned to make it through by the grace of God. And they're just sweet Christians. There's a fragrance about their life. There's a joy. There's something in there that I want to pull out and put in my pocket and take with me, because it's just pleasing to know they've been through that and God helped them. God can do that for you. Maybe tonight what you need more than anything else is an abundant supply of grace from the Lord Jesus Christ. Let him repair some things. Maybe let him take and help you see it's not personal. It's just a spiritual conflict that's taking place. Lord, I certainly do appreciate what we've heard tonight. And Lord, what a battle we're going to face, God. If this church builds a bigger building with a balcony in it, Lord, what a testimony that would be. What a joy if everybody won one person. Lord, what a joy that would be. But I pray, God, tonight you'd help some of these adults, some of these men and women that have been saved and in the fight for a while. And they've watched the missionaries go out and sometimes come home. And they've watched the husbands and wives part and come back together. And they've watched the children leave and come back. And they've watched the pastor struggle. I pray, God, tonight, God, I pray that what you'd help them do is maybe to look a little bit past and see there's bigger circumstances behind what's going on. And that they can get victory through your grace tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Preacher.
You know, sometimes we...